it has come to my attention that we need more listeners here at Raised by Toons. So what we're going to do, we're going to come together, we're going to listen to their newest episode and give them the better numbers than those top percentile podcasts that are out there making their billions and billions of dollars on Wall Street. And we're not going to do it. We're not going to listen to them anymore. And we're going to come out, and we're going to talk, and we're going to listen, and we're going to laugh. And that's been a message by me, Bernie Sanders. Where's that Reuben that I was looking for?
Hey, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Raised by Toons. I'm Dan, Mr. Potato Head Mason, and filling in for Ched, the Cat Bear Cook today, is our cartoon correspondent, Tiffany Sutton.
Hey, how you guys doing out there?
Always a strong open with Tiffany.
What? And
so, Chad's out today because he has a phobia of toys coming to life and attacking him. However, we do have some surprises around the corner, so we're just going to get right into it, Toonsters. Today, we are going to be reviewing Toy Story.
Woo!
You're my favorite deputy.
You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me.
Buzz, look, an alien! Where?
Rough ahead and you're miles and miles from the nice warm bed.
I'm Picasso.
I don't get it.
You just remember
you what you're cultured swine. What are you looking
you
at?
You got a friend in me.
It's not a laser.
Yeah,
it's a little light bulb with blinks.
What's with him?
Laser ending. Look, I'm Woody. Howdy, howdy, howdy.
You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. You got
some
trouble.
Pizza planet.
I got them too. There isn't anything.
Mom, do you know where Buzz is?
That's ma'am, I just want to say you're a bright young woman with a beautiful yarn full of hair for infinity and beyond.
You got a friend in me.
Randy Newman, an American legend, an icon, a god among men. Tiffany, can you tell the Toonsters out there a little something about Toy Story if they've never seen it before?
Well, Toy Story is pretty much the start of the amazing line of Pixar movies that were mainstream, and it's about a kid named Andy and his toys. And basically what it is his toys come to life. Well, actually, it's just showing that all toys come to life whenever you leave the room.
Try to describe it like it's not an insane horror movie. Start over.
No, man. Toys come to life when you aren't paying attention, when you leave the room. I mean, these toys are not evil. No one said they were evil. They just come to life and live and have, like, their own little, like, world when kids aren't playing with them.
Which is a brilliant, because it's sort of
it's
what you would think of
dream.
With Indian in the cupboard.
Right.
So Toy Story is about a pull-string cowboy named Woody, who was Andy's top toy for years.
His favorite toy. It's Andy's favorite.
And all of a sudden, it's Andy's birthday, and he's about to move, when all of a sudden, a new toy comes along, a space ranger named Buzz Lightyear.
Uh-oh, Buzz Lightyear kind of replaces Woody up on that pedestal that Woody's been on for years.
So as kids do, Andy slowly starts losing his interest in his best friend Woody, and starts focusing more on Buzz Lightyear.
His room changes to all Buzz Lightyear things when he used to be all cowboy things from Woody.
Some animosity begins between Woody and Buzz Lightyear.
Actually, the animosity is one-sided. It's pretty much all Woody against Buzz. And the thing about Buzz is, he doesn't know he's a toy. So this whole time, he's kind of oblivious to Woody's jealousy in the beginning of the movie because he thinks he's still on his Space Ranger mission. He has no idea he's a toy as Woody constantly tries to snap him into reality, saying, "You are a toy." You know, he thinks he can fly. He thinks he's on a mission. He thinks he's on a strange planet.
So we have a lot we want to get into here, Toonsters. One, we want to get to the cast of characters. We want to get into the voice actors. Toy Story, mind you, came out November 22nd, 1995, for anybody keeping track at home. I didn't forget, Chad, listening. Anyway, we have a special guest with us tonight. Now, you just heard one of his pieces of art through your eardrums, and he won many awards for this soundtrack. Ladies and gentlemen, for the first time ever on Raised by Toons, Randy Newman.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for having me.
Randy, it is such an honor. You have no idea. We are huge fans of your one Toy Story song. And
I did multiple songs, but I know you're only covering the first movie, so...
Well, you did have a few, actually, in the first movie. You had, like, three. You had, like, a lament when Buzz Lightyear was sort of snapping towards the end and realized he was a toy.
That's true. But I also composed the music as well where I didn't sing. But
yeah.
I tried to get as many as I wanted in where I'm singing, but they didn't want all the songs of me singing the whole time.
Why?
Well, I mean, some people find my voice very irritating.
No, Randy, your voice right now sounds like macaroni cheese melting just right down my eardrum. It's like beautiful.
That sounds delicious.
So, you got to do commercials. So, Randy, one of the trials and tribulations was coming up with... So Toy Story was sort of built on a foundation of... new territory. And with that, they needed... Well, one, they thought it was supposed to be a musical. Disney, that is. And Pixar did not make it a musical, per se. But they did give it one of the most famous, recognizable songs. You've Got a Friend in Me.
Yeah. I wrote that in like 3 seconds, man. It was crazy.
You know, wait, you wrote the award-winning You've Got a Friend in Me in only 3 seconds?
Yeah, all you gotta do is put words together... and then play it a little on the piano when it's, you got a hit.
You make it sound so easy. Were there any other processes that you needed to do? Or were there any other renditions of this song that you did?
Well, sometimes I like to eat chili cheese fries before I hit the piano keys.
That is not even the question I asked. I asked if you had any other versions of You've Got a Friend in Me.
Oh.
And you... You just told me about your lunch.
Sometimes I mishear things because, you know, being a musician and all.
Tiffany, you got a pretty voice. Ask Randy if there are any other versions or something. Maybe it's just me.
Are there any other versions of You've Got a Friend in Me?
Excellent job.
Well, there was one where it kind of went like, if I could remember it correctly, it was like, hey, you guy over there. You look pretty friendly, so why don't we live and play together? Something like that, I think.
I have goosebumps. Can you see that? Can you see that?
I see those goosebumps, and I wonder why they are there.
So why didn't they take that version? That sounds like it was pretty on the nose.
Well, it got pretty racy at the end, but, so we just reworded it around, and it became You Got a Friend in Me.
You worded it around a lot, actually, because that sounds like a completely original song.
A little bit more melancholy, but I brought it up in tempo.
Now, I was going through the archives a bit, and I found something that not a lot of Toy Story fans know. There was actually a hidden love song between Woody and Bo Peep.
Oh, yeah. That was I was smoking a little weed when I came up with that one. But it was, I believe that one was more like, hey, Mrs. Bo Peep, you lost your sheep, but something I got in my pants wants to lead you away from the rest of the farm. Something like that. I don't remember. It's been a while, so.
Randy, I can see why that one hit the chopping block.
Yeah.
So, now being a part of history, because going back to Toy Story, it was the first fully CGI movie, animated movie, ever. And it took a lot of risks They broke out of the fairy tale formula that was doing well for Disney at the time. They went through many different versions of the characters. Now, what about Toy Story makes Randy Newman think this was a part of history? Like, what did it feel like to be a part of that, and what was your favorite moment?
Well, you know, I've never seen talking toys before, so I thought that was pretty inventive. But I'd have to say that a space astronaut and a cowboy talking to each other, you don't see that every day. That was pretty crazy.
It was sort of an avant-garde take of sci-fi meeting Western, how the Westerns were sort of pushed out by sci-fi films and, like, new-age technology.
That is so deep.
Yep.
Very deep.
So I noticed that you also, after your success with Toy Story, you went on to do other films.
That's true.
Now, I heard that you have a really good Weekend at Bernie's song that never made it.
Oh, yeah, that was, I think it was like something with, we're gonna have a weekend with Bernie.
It's pretty much it. How did you do that? How do you do that?
It's very easy. I mean, like, if you give
you
me...
You take these complicated, it's like you almost have an algorithm for your words perfectly mixing with each other with the right touch of music to accompany it. It's like you're taking your vocals, putting them on a fluffy cloud, and floating them into the nether voids of my eardrums, Randy.
Wow, that was really descriptive.
Really descriptive. That's more descriptive than most of my songs.
Randy, you are not doing enough justice. Now, my favorite is you have a song when Buzz Lightyear realizes he is a toy and he is about to jump off the balcony. And
oh, yeah, he wants to prove to himself that he could fly.
Oh, yeah.
What was your mindset when you were writing that song?
Pretty much, I was drinking a lot, and I was kind of depressed at the time, so it fit, actually. And, I forget most of the lyrics, but I knew it
has been 20 years.
It has been 20 years. But I believe it was like, hey, I can't deal with me being not a toy or do a toy no more, so I'm going to jump off this banister that was made of wood.
Oh, my God. I'm tearing up right now. That was beautiful.
Although, you know, enough about me. What was your favorite part of the movie?
Oh, I'm so glad you asked, Randy. Asking me a question. This is new. Chad would have never done that. I gotta tell you about this. We have a co-host usually named Chad.
He sounds really cool.
No, he doesn't, Randy. No, he doesn't. I'm so glad that we have your beautiful, sultry voice instead of his cat squealing while whipping it around in a pillowcase sort of sound.
Wow.
But I would say my favorite is getting to first being introduced to the world. Now, when we first see these toys, we are seeing Andy playing with them and creating them like a bank robbery sort of thing where Woody comes in and saves the day. And then when Andy leaves the room, everyone comes to life and they have their own personality and they have their own way to go from their character into who they really are. And I just thought it was really creative because you never saw this before.
Yeah, they have their own personal life, their own personal dynamics with each other, their own friendships and relationships, and you can really see the individualized toys and who they are and how, like, they actually live their lives outside of their frozen toy world, you know? It's like they lead another life. You know, by day, they play with Andy. By night, they live in their own little personal world and do their own thing, and it's kind of like, what do toys do when they want to just do whatever they want to do? You know what I mean? Like, what do they do on their free time when they're not being played with? This movie kind of answers that question.
There's also that dynamic of, which I think is really cool. There's this whole, the meaning of the toy's existence is to be played with. And all of their motives and actions sort of are like what what are their fears and their desires and their, like I said, motives are driven on that basis.
They have an extreme loyalty to the child that owns them.
Right. Yeah. So it's sort of fascinating to see what drives a character based on complete selflessness. And that, as it goes into the story and the characters sort of go into Act Two, where we'll get into in a second, it's really cool to see what drives them.
Yeah, it's like their whole purpose in life is to just make Andy happy, you know? That's like their motivation for doing everything, and it's their like love of being a toy. It's really, really cute.
Now, Randy.
Yeah?
Let's talk about characters.
Okay.
There is an ensemble of characters in this movie that are completely different from each other. They are totally polarizing, and it makes it fascinating to watch. You have, as every Toonster will know, you have Woody, the pull-string cowboy.
Mm-hmm.
You have the Space Ranger Buzz Lightyear.
Yeah.
Now, what were some of your favorite characters?
Well, I like the Piggy Bank, because he held
Ham.
Ham, yeah.
Voiced by John Ratzenberger, everyone.
He was, he had a lot of, you know, change in him. And sometimes...
It sounds like there's a song about that, but Tiffany, who are some of your favorite characters?
Oh, yeah, I was actually going to... Can I, like, take a step back before we talk about that?
Yeah.
Just one of the things that I also... If I were to answer Randy's question that he asked you, one of my favorite things that I liked about the movie, especially because when I saw this movie, I was a child, was the fact that there was a lot of toys that I actually recognized.
Mm.
Disney or Pixar got a lot of rights to actual toy brand toys. You know, we saw a lot of Play School toys, a lot of Tinker Tots.
Weeble Wobbles.
Yeah, the board games like Candyland and Mousetrap. Like, they got legit, like, toy brands and just recreated them for this big screen.
Mr. Potato Head.
They had Slinky. They had Mr. Potato Head. It's like a whole bunch of toys that everyone actually kind of grew up with. The phone, the play phone with the cord and the little, like, face on it. All these things. And the thing about these toys are they spanned over tons of generations. So it wasn't just like, oh, it's the toys that I grew up with as a child. But, like, when my parents took me to the movies to see it, it's also, like, toys that they played with as well. Like, those toys are kind of timeless, and they were around for years. So it's kind of one of those things that everyone can identify with. And as you're watching the story unfold, you're just like, oh, I used to have that toy. Oh, the little Green Army Men. Like, I used to play with that. You know, it's just kind of like a whole world that used to be. It's kind of like you can identify because they're the same toys you grew up with.
Fun fact, segueing back into the cast, and then we'll ask Tiffany what some of her favorite characters are. Etch-a-Sketch was actually saved by this movie because they were about to go bankrupt, and then when it was featured in Toy Story, their sales improved 20% instantly.
That's awesome.
That's crazy.
I used to have an Etch-a-Sketch, and that was one of my favorite things that I used to play with forever. It was just, they had Magic 8-Ball, so many good toys that you could recognize.
Now, I say it segues because the Etch-a-Sketch was a character.
Yes.
Now, Tiffany, mm-hmm. What are some of your favorite characters?
It's funny you ask. Well, first of all, I've always had a soft spot for Woody. For a few reasons, because, well, Tom Hanks is the voice of Woody, and who doesn't love Tom Hanks,
right? Oh, he's the modern Jimmy Stewart.
Who, right? Okay, first of all, Tom Hanks, amazing.
Who's actually been a ghost in our studio many times.
Right? So, Woody, I kind of identified with Woody a lot. I just felt like, who's this Buzz character? I just always, even as a kid, I just felt so bad that this other toy came in to replace him. I also really liked Bo Peep. I thought that was cute.
That's a hidden gem there.
Yeah, and Bo Peep was one of those characters that they came up with because they actually couldn't get the rights to Mattel, so they couldn't have a Barbie in the first movie. Eventually, they got Barbie.
Yeah, everyone came crawling out of the mud.
Yeah, it was like after Toy Story
got $360 million
hit like the top number one, like the top grossing movie of all time. Everyone's like, here, take my toys.
People love money.
Right?
Money.
So after Toy Story became so huge.
Sorry, Randy, that was so rude of me.
No, that was pretty good impression.
Sorry.
This is chaos in the studio today. After Toy Story did so well, they were able to get more rights to more toys. And one of the things that they did eventually get was Mattel, and they were able to get Barbie. Sad thing is, when they got Barbie, Bo Peep kind of disappears, and they kind of mention the fact that Bo Peep is gone in the third movie. Unfortunately, they mention that she's given away or something like that, and she's no longer with them.
Yeah, it was actually a $30 million budget for Toy Story, and the box office was $362 million. So everyone probably came running to throw their toys at them right after that.
Feature our toys.
They even had me do songs for the commercials for some of the toys.
Oh, really?
What toys did you do?
Like, you were talking about Etch-A-Sketch before. I believe Etch-A-Sketch was like, "We're going to etch it. We're going to sketch it. Come on down and turn my knobs. We got to sketch it all night long."
So, see, now, I appreciate that, Randy, but now I feel like I don't remember that growing up.
Also, they really let you say "turn my knobs" on a commercial for children's
I don't time? Remember this commercial, Randy. What happened?
Well, I think it was shown on the air, but you know when they show late night commercials?
Hmm.
I think that's when they aired it, and I've only seen $1 from those commercials, so I don't know how long they ran it.
Now, isn't it true that they were originally going to make an animated Toy Story cartoon that you were going to voice Mr. Potato Head?
Oh,
and it just never saw the light of day?
I think, yeah, that was possible, but I don't think I played it angry enough. I was more of a Southern Belle.
Why were you a Southern Belle?
I don't even get into it, you know?
No, I probably should. It's my job. So okay. Can you give us, like, a clip of what one of those readings was like?
Sure. I think here's when Woody pushes the car out the truck at the end.
Oh, so they just redid the episodes were just the movie?
Well, they broke it up into five parts.
Okay, so they just rehashed it. Okay.
So it was just like, "Oh, there he goes again." You know, that's pretty much how we sounded.
That was not bad. That wasn't bad.
Mm-hmm.
So Toy Story, like we said, sort of paved the way and really gave Pixar its legs.
Yeah.
And you'd be hard-pressed to find anyone who hasn't seen Toy Story or been influenced by it. But what you might not have known is all the steps taken to get to where it was. Now, without Tim Burton's Nightmare Before Christmas, Disney was not going to greenlight Toy Story. They want to take a chance on it because it's a lot of money and a lot of hours spent, and they've never done anything outside of the Disney studio before. They've never went to outside companies to produce work. But once they finally got their foot in the door and they started getting the ball rolling on the story, there were initially like three different reincarnations of the story. And one had Woody as a jackass, which...
a literal jackass?
No, like a jerk. Like,
oh.
He was a prick.
Oh, okay. I thought you meant a donkey.
Which, at the D23 Expo this last few months ago, there was a Toy Story 20th anniversary, and they had a few executives talk about it. And Woody was originally an asshole, and Buzz Lightyear was Lunar Larry... And then they switched his name to The Tempest, and then they switched his name to Buzz Lightyear for Buzz Aldrin.
I'm glad they did that, because The Tempest is the dumbest name.
That's like Shakespeare or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Very good, Randy. So what I'm asking is, we're so comfortable, like, it feels like the pieces just fit perfectly now, but can you speculate on how different the movie would have been if Woody... Well, originally, too, to go back before I get your opinions on this, Woody was the Tin Soldier from that short Pixar did before Toy Story.
Oh.
Do you guys remember that?
Slightly, but not totally.
That, Well, it was based on him and a ventriloquist dummy. Woody was a ventriloquist dummy.
Oh, yeah.
So it was going to be their adventure, and Woody was an asshole, and then they got the Space Ranger in. Could you speculate for us what it would have been like with Asshole Woody and Lunar Larry, who was also 6 inches tall?
Well, Woody, he would mistreat Bo Peep. He would say negative things about her and then compliment her right after, leading her on and such. And then he would also...
So Woody was like a guy from the Jersey Shore, huh?
Pretty, sort of, but still with the Tom Hanks accent. And but how can that man be mean? I don't know.
Well, you were telling me about his brother.
Oh, yes. Sometimes when Tom wasn't around or he was too busy, he'd have his brother Jim come in and he'd record voices for Woody around. And he was able to be a bit angry and a bit meaner. But hey, you know, we went with the right Hanks.
You went?
I'd sort of had a collaboration because to create the music, I needed to know who the voices were. And I never met Tom Hanks before, but he does sure make a good peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
That's some stuff we're looking for. Tiffany, can you speculate for us just like what you thought the story might have been with some of these earlier revisions?
It sounds like kids probably wouldn't have liked it as much. I'm sure with Woody being an asshole or a jerk, no one would empathize with him or at all. I mean, the way that they made Toy Story in the final cut, Woody starts out as this lovable, understanding leader of the toys. And when Buzz shows up, you see him go through a whole bunch of changes, and you do get to see his ugly side. I mean, he does get like extremely jealous, which brings out the worst in him. So you get to see like a different side of Woody, and he's more of a round character, and he transitions from being this lovable character to this jealous, you know, begrudging toy. And so at least this way we kind of see like the transition or the change, and we might even empathize with his feelings because we saw the development happen between what the love Andy used to have for Woody versus what happened when Buzz became Andy's new toy. So I feel like if Woody had started out as an asshole, where could the story have gone, and who would have cared about Woody ever?
So to tell the Toonsters who haven't seen Toy Story, where does the story begin to shift? Where does our act two take us?
Okay, so once Buzz has established himself as the... Well, once Buzz gets established as the new toy, in the beginning we see Woody as the hero to a lot of these toys. Slinky Dog was Woody's like best friend, and he looked up to him a lot. And all the other toys just kind of was like, oh, Woody, you know, Woody slept on the bed. He was on this pedestal. And once Buzz came in, you start to see the toys' attention change over to Buzz. They're more impressed with Buzz's lasers and his big wings that flip out and his helmet that goes back and comes on and all of his cool like buttons and sounds that he makes.
Laser envy.
Yeah, Woody's got laser envy. So you start to see a shift in everyone's attention, and Woody's starting to just really get pushed off, not only by Andy, but by the other toys. He gets pushed into the background, which he's not used to. You know, he's used to being on this pedestal. So at one point in the movie, Woody decides that, you know, he wants to be the toy that Andy takes out to dinner to Pizza Planet, and he knows that Andy's going to choose Buzz. You know, his mom says that he can only bring one toy, so of course he's going to choose Buzz, and Woody wants it to be him. So he gets this plan to kind of try to knock Buzz behind the desk so Buzz could not be seen, but instead his plan goes wrong and he gets knocked out the window. And
he did it again!
So, yeah, so the toys kind of gang up on Woody, but before they can do anything to him, Andy comes in, so they have to freeze, and Andy takes Woody, not really wanting to, kind of begrudgingly, to Pizza Planet. And on the way to the car, Buzz grabs on to, I guess, the bumper of the car, and they are off to Pizza Planet, and Buzz confronts Woody, and they have this whole hash out between them, and they fight, and they go through this whole, like, conflict until they are at Pizza Planet and they get stuck in a claw machine.
Mm-hmm.
And the next door neighbor, who is a terror to toys. All he does is destroy. Sid destroys toys. He actually gets them out of the claw machine. And once they get taken to Sid's house, there is a shift in the dynamic because they have to survive the torture chamber that is Sid's room, basically.
Now, Randy, can you tell us a little bit about Sid?
Well, he was a troubled kid who, he was very destructive. He liked explosives and whatnot. But one thing he had was a traumatic experience at the dentist when he got his braces.
You can see it on his face.
Yeah, and, you know, so he took it out on his sister's dolls and whatnot. And then he would, you know, take the toys apart and replace them. He pretended he was a doctor, a scientist even. And he even tried to bring himself up in the world through his toys.
Now, Randy, one of my favorite songs of yours didn't make the actual cut of the CD.
Mm-hmm.
But, sorry, that moan caught me off guard. But there's a song, a beautiful song, called Sid, You're No Good, But You're Not That Bad.
Oh, yeah.
Can you give us a little taste of that, like, while we have you here in person?
Sure. So, Sid, you're such a naughty little boy. You take your toys and you smash them on the ground, screaming your mommy's name. What did your mommy do to you? No one knows. That was pretty much part of it.
Oh, because I was thinking the second verse where he's looking eye to eye with the toy and he's sort of talking to the toy on his last sort of, like, it's not you, toy, it's me. That part was beautiful.
Oh, yeah, it was like, sometimes I don't know why I do this to you. You're just a toy, and I'm just a boy. So we're gonna be different people or things.
There's something so beautiful about that. You're a poet.
Thank you.
You're Ibsen. You're Ibsen.
Wow.
So, Randy, I feel like some of your work's not appreciated.
No, you know, some people take it as a joke. Like one of my hits, Short People, it's taken negatively because they thought I really hated short people. But I don't. It was sort of a criticism on people who hate, you know. And people used to play it all the time. But, hey, that was one of my better songs.
Who could forget Short People by Randy Newman?
It's very catchy.
So, moving forward, let's talk a little bit about the talent they had before we go into our last act with cartoon correspondent Tiffany Sutton.
Sweet!
So, the voice talents they have, Tom Hanks, Tim Allen, Wallace Shawn, Don Rickles was Mr. Potato Head, and the Jim Varney.
Ernest, for the people who don't know.
Yeah. Like, Ernest. There were so many talented people that lent a hand to this one. Now, where was I going with this?
The talent?
Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah. Did anybody stand out to you, just for specifically their voice work, for Tiffany or Randy?
I'd have to say it was Tim Allen, you know, because I used to know him back in the Home Improvement days, and he was just a normal guy, but then he became this space astronaut.
No, you know that was just a character, right?
He wasn't a spaceman?
No, that was actually, it was a CGI character named Buzz Lightyear.
Oh, yeah.
And on Home Improvement, he wasn't actually
A tool man.
Yeah, he was actually an actor.
But they had his toolbox in one of the scenes of the movie.
Yeah, they did. They actually did have a Binford Tools toolbox at Sid's house that trapped Woody on top of the crate. Excellent eye there, Randy.
Thank you.
How about we use this as a perfect segue into some behind-the-scenes facts for Toy Story.
Okay, let's do it.
No, I'm going to need a little more gusto from our cartoon correspondent over here.
So wait. behind the scenes facts.
Yeah, some behind the scenes things that some people might not have known. Do you guys have any gems that you remember?
You mean like Easter eggs?
Yeah, Easter eggs, things, the making of. You're a cartoon correspondent. And you're Randy Newman.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for noticing.
Thank you. they had when he's giving his speech in the beginning, Woody, he's doing on top of a Tinker Toy bowl or some kind of thing.
Oh, the Tinker Toys box. Yes, yes. I have one.
Oh, yeah? What do you got?
When Woody is trying to knock Buzz behind the desk, the globe gets knocked down and starts rolling towards Buzz. It's actually an homage to Indiana Jones when the boulder is coming after Indiana Jones, and they actually use the exact same sound from that movie in Toy Story as well. So it sounds like the same boulder chasing Indiana.
Oh,
I believe the Pizza Planet delivery truck has appeared in every Pixar movie.
Oh, I like that.
That's
one.
What I was looking for.
That's a good one.
These gems, people, these gems.
To actually move and come at him. So when Sid is outside, Woody's pull string voice starts to come through, and Sid thinks it's busted until Woody starts actually making remarks about Sid and saying Sid's name. Then all the toys start moving towards Sid, and he's telling Sid basically he has to treat his toys better. And then at the end, Woody actually like moves and speaks, and Sid freaks out.
So play nice.
Yeah, Sid freaks out. And he basically gets his comeuppance for all the torture he's given to those poor innocent toys. And Buzz is saved. Now, you think that the toys are in the clear, but no. The stakes keep getting higher.
Pixar is very famous for raising the stakes, raising them again, and then raising them four more times.
So by the time he rescues Buzz from the rocket and they are free to go back next door to Andy's house, Andy and his family are pulling out of the driveway with the moving truck. They're out of there. So Buzz and Woody have to try to catch up with the truck so they can get on it and they can move with the rest of Andy's toys. Buzz finally is able to catch up with the moving truck, and because he does, Woody gets caught up with the moving truck and Buzz gets left behind. So in order to save Buzz, Woody pulls out the race car and kicks it off the truck.
What do you say, the race card?
Nope, the race car, and kicks off the truck, and the other toys think that he's doing to the race car what he did to Buzz.
He's doing it again.
Yeah, and they start attacking Woody and stuff and throw him off the truck, and then Woody and Buzz Buzz has the race car and comes up and grabs Woody, and they start racing towards the moving van. The toys see Woody and Buzz. They see that Woody's not actually this terrible, crazy toy trying to destroy all the other toys, and they have to try to get them onto the moving truck and work together. And doesn't quite work out that way. The car's batteries die, so they have
to... Of course.
Yep. They decide to light that rocket and make Buzz actually fly. So he gets to fly, ladies and gentlemen, and they end up making it to Andy's car, and happy ending. They're all friends.
To infinity and beyond, right, Randy?
Yeah.
Now, you wrote a song for the credits. How did that go?
I believe it was just the main song, the You Got a Friend in Me.
Now, but I mean the original one before...
Oh, the original song. That was more like, hey, the toys have made it. They made it in the car. You can get ready to be played with by Andy. So then we turn to his room, and everybody's happy. So let's go play in the bathroom, in the bathtub, in the sink.
How do you feel about critics saying that your lyrics are too on the nose?
Well, what I have to say to them is they could go fuck themselves.
Because
I got an Oscar, so...
Yeah.
I like that.
All right, Randy.
Yeah. Can I just add that the ending of this film set up a sequel?
Yep, they did well with that. So, Tiffany, What cereal do you think would accompany a viewing of Toy Story the best?
Ooh, that's a good question. I'm going to say Lucky Charms. I always feel like the more happy-go-lucky the movie, the more happy-go-lucky my cereal should be. And what's happier than a bowl full of marshmallows?
I'll tell you what's happier. Randy Newman coming up with a song right now for Lucky Charms.
Oh, that's a real challenge. Yeah, let's see if I can do that. You got regular tasteless cereal in the bowl, but then you add a constellation of marshmallows, then you're gonna get a tasty meal. It's the breakfast that you can't eat like a seal. So that's the song for Lucky Charms.
Wow.
They're going to be paying you buckets of money. Tables of money.
You're gonna get an Oscar for that cereal.
You're gonna get an Oscar for that jingle.
I'm going for my EGOT, actually.
Oh, wow.
Wow, that's...
What?
That's big.
But you're not even close in any of the other categories.
I think I got a Grammy. I don't remember.
Yeah. But you're not gonna get, like...
A Tony. He's going for Broadway.
Oh.
He's going after Broadway.
Yeah, it's
next.
A one-man show.
Oh, what is it? Just Randy?
Just Randy. That's it. That's actually the name.
If that doesn't work out, maybe you could just write your own musical.
That's true. I could do that.
What would your musical be?
It would have to be How to Play the Piano.
That's the musical?
What if it was Toy Story the musical?
Ooh. It could be that. I mean, I really wouldn't have to do much. It's already made.
Yeah. There you go. You could just maybe just add a couple more original songs to it and boom.
Just cut the check.
That's true. That is true.
I think the cereal I would choose
mm-hmm.
would be every cereal with a toy inside. They don't do it much anymore. And I think it's a little homage to the good days where there's a living toy inside your cereal. And until you open the box, they are just touching all your food.
They're buried alive by your food.
Yep.
Oh my.
Now, was there any sort of anything that you guys wanted to leave the Toonsters with before we review this thing? Actually, review it, and then that will be your little what you would like to tell the Toonsters. Let's start with our cartoon correspondent, Tiffany Sutton.
What is this out of?
Five. You've been on 10 episodes.
You know what? It's hard to keep up with you guys because stuff changes in this office. So, you know. I'm going to give Toy Story a 4 out of 5 only because I think I like the third Toy Story even better than the original Toy Story. So I'm going to have to say a 4 out of 5 because I think the third one is a little star better.
Very, very good, Tiffany. Randy?
I'm going to have to give the first Toy Story movie about 5. Are we doing stars or what are we doing out of?
Whatever you want.
How about 5 out of 5?
Green Army Men. Yeah, I like it. Green Army Men.
And I'm saying that only because I still get residuals for the movie. So
every time somebody says Toy Story, they owe you?
Yeah.
That's a good reason, actually. That's a good reason for a 5 out of 5 Green Army Men. Dan, what about you? How many Green Army Men would you give Toy Story?
Well, I believe that Toy Story paved the way for a lot of... they opened the door for Pixar, and Pixar alone has created a formula to make things funny, endearing, and magical all at the same time. Mm-hmm. Toy Story was the first to do this, and when you look back at it, the animation isn't as good because it's one of the first. Also, there's a thing where their eyes blink
separately?
One at a time. Because, I don't know, they just couldn't master that at the time, I guess. But there's little things like that. But there's enough clever things where they have the carpet from The Shining as one of the things. The writing where just Mrs. Nesbitt.
Oh, my God.
Where Buzz loses his mind and he's having tea with Marie Antoinette and Marie Antoinette's sister. and he's dressed in an apron, and he's Mrs. Nesbit. It's the little moments like that really make this just a timeless piece that you can watch over and over again. And it holds up a lot better than the second one. The third one's amazing, but the magic all starts here. I'm going to go give it 4 out of 5. Why? What?
You built it up so much, like you were about to give it the four top out of five honor.
From, 4 out of 5 from Dan Mason oh is a God. Really good score.
Right, he made it sound like he was going to top mine because it was the original Pixar film. It paved the way. It was the building blocks. It was the first.
I don't get a residual like, every time I fucking hype up Toy Story, so like, they will get my honest to God raised by Toon.
And then it was like a 1 out of 5. Like, I what? Know,
4 out of 5 is not a 1 out of 5. If I was going to do a 5 out of 5, their eyes should blink at the same fucking time.
Maybe they only did that because they're not human.
They're toys.
Their eyes blink in the other ones.
You don't know.
Yeah, what? I do.
Well, let's pull out Toy Story 3 and see it.
Okay, Toonsters, sit down. We're going to watch Toy Story 3 quick, and then we'll get back to you. I hope you have an hour and a fucking half to listen to this podcast.
I think Toy Story 3 is like 2 hours, actually.
2 hours?
I think it's really long.
No, it was just a thing. But... sorry, Randy, you looked like I upset you.
Oh, no, I don't get upset that easily.
So, that's gonna do it for us, but before we go, Toonsters, Randy, I hate to ask, but please, could you give Raised by Toons a little jingle that we might be able to play on our page?
Sure, but before I do that, I just want to say you can reach me at just hashtag Randy Newman. That I'll just pop up, usually. You don't really need to be specific where. Just search it.
Are you plugging just yourself?
Yeah.
Oscar-winning.
Not many people know me.
Oscar and Grammy-winning Randy Newman is just plugging your hashtag?
Just hashtag Randy Newman.
That doesn't necessarily correspond with you.
Yeah, man, it does. Because you hashtag him, he comes up.
Anytime I mention, I pop up.
But also, if you say your name in reverse 3 times in front of a mirror, you pop up too, I hear.
That's true because I made a bad deal with the, you know, Faust.
Is that why you always sound like angel kisses to us? Because you just made a deal with the devil?
I believe so, but, you know, let's just get to the Raised by Toons song.
Sing us, ladies and gentlemen, Raised by Toons for the first time in history, Randy Newman, Raised by Toons.
I'm just a latchkey kid coming home from school. Pulling the key from out the rug. Going in the house, turning on the TV. Then I pull out my old blanky Stevie. And then I get raised by Toons. But then my mom says the time I should stop watching. But I'm like, this is my real mom, not you. So don't talk to me. You stupid bitch.
Keep going.
You don't know where I come from, cause I'm from the hood. The hood that you've seen on TV too. Bill Cosby and the Fat Albert kids, they're the best kids on the block. Raised by Toons!
Yeah!
That was something!
It was like I was there with you, Randy Newman.
Thank you.
So that's going to do it for us on Raised by Toons today, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, cartoon correspondent Tiffany Sutton.
Yeah, you're welcome.
And thank you, special guest Randy Newman.
Thank you.
And remember, if you weren't raised by Toons, you weren't raised right.
Thanks for listening to the Raised by Toons podcast. Be sure to visit their website at www.raisedbytoonspodcast.com. If you haven't already, subscribe to their podcast on iTunes, and don't forget to follow them on Twitter and Facebook. Tune in next week to listen to two grown men who peaked in middle school try to